But the history of consumer-grade wearable devices depends on your definition of what constitutes a wearable. For our purposes, we will avoid the general definition of a wearable as being any item worn by its user to improve their experience or interaction of or with the outside world. And that saves us from recounting the history of spectacles or the pocket watch, for example.
The wearables I'm talking about here are devices worn on or near the human body or on clothing, and which consist of a recognition region, a transducer element, and an electronic circuitry, which usually consists of an amplifier, a processor, and a visualizing display.
These three elements combine to detect and in some way quantify, analyze, or visualize information about body signals to in some way make them actionable. For our purposes, the measurement or quantification of a body signal is the defining factor.
The precursors to consumer-grade wearable biosensors were the invasive biosensor devices of the controlled laboratory environment. In 1956, Leland C. Clark, who was known as the father of biosensors, was the first to use electrodes for the detection of oxygen levels in blood. He designed a device for continuous and real-time detection of oxygen in operating room settings during cardiovascular surgery. The introduction of electrodes for healthcare purposes was later followed by the discovery of potentiometric biosensors for the assessment of urea in 1969, and then the commercialization of the first glucose analyzer in 1975. Biosensors continued to gain popularity during the 1980s with the introduction of fiber optic and mass sensitive piezoelectric devices. In the 1990s, the field continued to advance with subcutaneously implantable needle-type electrodes for real-time in vivo glucose monitoring, and then with nanomaterial-based biosensors. All of these advances in biosensor technology over the past five decades paved the way for consumer-grade wearable devices. The first commercially available wearable biosensor that achieved widespread adoption was the Fitbit Classic. This was the first wireless activity tracker that could synchronize data with the internet and have the same data available on a mobile phone. It also had a sleek form factor. 2014 can be considered the year of the wearable activity tracker boom. A key innovator was Basis, whose wristband differed from the state of the art at the time by collecting data such as heart rate and estimated calorie consumption based on activity levels. And then big tech came on board. At the end of 2014, Google introduced Wear OS. Wear OS was the first operating system specifically designed for wearable devices, particularly for smartwatches. Then Apple released its first wearable, the Apple Watch, in 2015.
In the long term, different types of biosensors will deliver advanced analytics to explore and develop functionalities akin to truly portable medical laboratories. But to understand this potential, we must first consider how wearable biosensors actually work.
Well, all body signals begin with the interaction between a biological receptor and an analyte. A biological receptor or bioreceptor can either be an enzyme, a cell, a tissue, a nucleic acid, an antibody. It doesn't really matter. What matters is that the interaction between the bioreceptor and an analyte creates a signal. This signal may take the form of a change in light, charge, mass, heat, or some other entity. Whatever that basic signal may be, keep in mind that it is represented in higher level functions at the system level, like the beating of your heart, the activity in your brain, the contraction of a muscle, or the movement of your limbs. In any case, the interaction between the bioreceptor and its analyte is called biorecognition. Biorecognition usually results in the emission of a signal, and the recognition region and transducer of the wearable device together play the key role in converting that basic physical, chemical, or electrical signal into another kind of measurable signal. This conversion of one form of energy signal to another by the biotransducer is termed signalization. Generally, biotransducers generate either optical or electrical signals, and these are somewhat proportional to the concentration of the analyte-bioreceptor interaction that kicks the whole process off. Now, it's important to highlight that the signal that is generated by the biotransducer often contains incomplete information about the underlying signal. There are often errors, inconsistencies, and noise. It's rare that signalization produces a perfect representation of the underlying biological signal. To accommodate this, once the data is gathered, it generally needs to be processed. It needs to be filtered, structured, cleaned, and validated to improve its actionability, to actually make it meaningful and a valid representation of the underlying biological signal. The processing stage can be extremely complex. Entire strands of research exist investigating the best way to process a biological signal to ensure that they are valid and reliable and that they represent the underlying signal. But I'm not going to delve into that research here.
What you should know is that wearable devices which measure body signals come in many forms.
For example, heart rate can be measured using an optical sensor that detects changes in light at the sensor's location. Blood oxygenation can be measured with an oximeter built into a ring. Muscle activity with an electromyographic sensor embedded into clothing. Stress can be assessed using an electrodermal sensor incorporated into a wristband. And physical activity or sleep can be evaluated via an accelerometer in a watch. And this is by no means an exhaustive list. In fact, biofluids like sweat, tears, saliva, and interstitial fluid have been targeted as they can be sampled in a non-invasive manner, meaning that they can be readily accessed without disrupting the outermost layers of the skin, the stratum corneum, and without the need for a sample of blood. The major focus of commercially available healthcare wearable devices to date has been on motion tracking. At its most basic level, motion tracking is used to gauge a user's level of physical activity. Motion trackers like pedometers can keep track of daily step counts, a proxy for overall levels of physical activity.
But the majority of wearable manufacturers stress the potential of their devices to become all-in-one platforms for improving physical performance and positive habit formation. Wearable manufacturers are starting to use a range of digital persuasive techniques and social influence strategies to try and increase user engagement, including the gamification of activity with competitions and challenges, providing visual feedback on performance, or positive reinforcement in the form of virtual rewards for achievements. There is also a growing population of wearable users specifically interested in the concept of self-discovery through personal analytics, the quantified self movement.
A number of scientific and popular publications describe methods and techniques for using consumer wearables as biohacking devices to improve sleep, manage stress, or increase productivity. But do these interventions actually make people healthier? Current empirical evidence is not supportive.
Evidence for the effectiveness of quantified self methods come from single subject reports of users describing their experiences. Subjective reports like these cannot be treated as reliable scientific evidence. Very few longitudinal randomized control studies focus on the impact of wearable technology on healthy users' behavior, and those available to us are often contradictory.
For example, in one 12-week randomized control trial, researchers found that giving elderly people pedometers with regular consultation visits was associated with an increase in their daily physical activity. But in another study of young adults with a BMI between 25 and less than 40, the addition of wearable technology device to a standard behavioral intervention actually resulted in less weight loss over a period of 24 months.
The issue seems to be one of adherence. These devices fail to drive long-term sustained engagement for a majority of users because, simply put, they stop using them.
A survey conducted in 2013 showed that 32% of users stopped wearing these devices after 6 months and 50% after 1 year.
Poor implementation of user experience principles, alongside the ad hoc design of user interfaces, stems in part from the rapid nature of development, which may also explain the lack of randomized trials in the field. Those who market and develop consumer-level devices may underestimate the distance between designing a product that appears to be associated with a healthy lifestyle and providing evidence to support this underlying assumption. But the problem that the wearable solution seems to be looking for may be coming into focus, at least for specific cohorts of wellness and fitness enthusiasts.
In a 2019 survey of the general population, wearable ownership was up 22%, an increase of 12% among the same cohort 3 years earlier. So they do seem to offer some value to specific cohorts. For example, recent evidence suggests that approximately 75% of runners participating in a marathon reported using wearable technology for training optimization and distance recording. Interestingly, females and runners in higher age groups were less likely to use wearables. Similar trends of wearable biosensor use have been documented in anecdotal reports among cyclists and swimmers.
But beyond activity monitoring and the measurement of blood oxygenation or heart rate, the primary issue with currently available consumer wearable biosensors is that few, if any, have been independently validated to determine their accuracy and reliability. The companies selling these products tend to deliver well-crafted pitches about how their product will change your life or allow you to take the next steps in your athletic endeavors, but generally fail to back up their claims with large, longitudinal, independently gathered data sets. This is true of wearable biosensors for monitoring hydration status, metabolism, training loads, movement patterns, injury risk, psychological stress, or that claim to promote better sleep or evaluate cognitive function. You see, because these companies are targeting healthy individuals, they don't have to adhere to the same strict rules that need to be followed if a wearable biosensor is to be classified as a medical device.